Aladdin Story Part 7. The Grand Vizier's son, who was almost perished with cold by standing in his thin undergarment all night, no sooner heard the knocking at the door than he got out of bed and ran into the robing chamber, where he had undressed himself the night before. The Sultan, having opened the door, went to the bedside, kissed the princess on the forehead, but was extremely surprised to see her look so melancholy. She only cast at him a sorrowful look, expressive of great affliction. He suspected there was something extraordinary in this silence, and thereupon went immediately to the sultaness's apartment, told her in what a state he found the princess, and how she had received him. "Sire," said the sultaness, "I will go and see her, she will not receive me in the same manner." The princess received her mother with sighs and tears, and signs of deep dejection. At last, upon her pressing on her the duty of telling her all her thoughts, she gave to the sultaness a precise description of all that happened to her during the night, on which the sultaness enjoined on her the necessity of silence and discretion, as no one would give credence to so strange a tale. The Grand Vizier's son, elated with the honor of being the Sultan's son-in-law, kept silence on his part, and the events of the night were not allowed to cast the least gloom on the festivities on the following day, in continued celebration of the royal marriage. When night came, the bride and bridegroom were again attended to their chamber with the same ceremonies as on the preceding evening. Aladdin, knowing that this would be so, had already given his commands to the genie of the lamp, and no sooner were they alone than their bed was removed in the same mysterious manner as on the preceding evening, and having passed the night in the same unpleasant way, they were in the morning conveyed to the palace of the Sultan. Scarcely had they been replaced in their apartment than the Sultan came to make his compliments to his daughter, when the princess could no longer conceal from him the unhappy treatment she had been subjected to, and told him all that had happened, as she had already related it to her mother. The Sultan, on hearing these strange tidings, consulted with the Grand Vizier, and finding from him that his son had been subjected to even worse treatment by an invisible agency, he determined to declare the marriage to be cancelled, and all the festivities, which were yet to last for several days, to be countermanded and terminated. This sudden change in the mind of the Sultan gave rise to various speculations and reports. Nobody but Aladdin knew the secret, and he kept it with the most scrupulous silence, and neither the Sultan nor the Grand Vizier, who had forgotten Aladdin and his request, had the least thought that he had any hand in the strange adventures that befell the bride and bridegroom. On the very day that the 3 months contained in the Sultan's promise expired, the mother of Aladdin again went to the palace, and stood in the same place in the divan. The Sultan knew her again, and directed his vizier to have her brought before him. After having prostrated herself, she made answer, in reply to the Sultan, "Sire, I come at the end of 3 months to ask of you the fulfillment of the promise you made to my son." The Sultan little thought the request of Aladdin's mother was made to him in earnest, or that he would hear any more of the matter. He therefore took counsel with his vizier, who suggested that the Sultan should attach such conditions to the marriage that no one in the humble condition of Aladdin could possibly fulfill. In accordance with this suggestion of the vizier, the Sultan replied to the mother of Aladdin, "Good woman, it is true sultans ought to abide by their word, and I am ready to keep mine, by making your son happy in marriage with the princess my daughter. But as I cannot marry her without some further proof of your son being able to support her in royal state, you may tell him I will fulfill my promise as soon as he shall send me 40 trays of massy gold, full of the same sort of jewels you have already made me a present of, and carried by the like number of black slaves, who shall be led by as many young and handsome white slaves, all dressed magnificently. On these conditions, I am ready to bestow the princess my daughter upon him. Therefore, good woman, go and tell him so, and I will wait till you bring me his answer." Aladdin's mother prostrated herself a second time before the Sultan's throne, and retired. On her way home, she laughed within herself at her son's foolish imagination. "Where," said she, "can he get so many large gold trays, and such precious stones, to fill them? It is altogether out of his power, and I believe he will not be much pleased with my embassy this time." When she came home, full of these thoughts, she told Aladdin all the circumstances of her interview with the Sultan, and the conditions on which he consented to the marriage. "The Sultan expects your answer immediately," said she, and then added, laughing, "I believe he may wait long enough." "Not so long, mother, as you imagine," replied Aladdin. "This demand is a mere trifle, and will prove no bar to my marriage with the princess. I will prepare at once to satisfy his request." Aladdin retired to his own apartment and summoned the genie of the lamp, and required him to immediately prepare and present the gift, before the Sultan closed his morning audience according to the terms in which it had been prescribed. The genie professed his obedience to the owner of the lamp and disappeared. Within a very short time, a train of 40 black slaves, led by the same number of white slaves, appeared opposite the house in which Aladdin lived. Each black slave carried on his head a basin of massy gold, full of pearls, diamonds, rubies, and emeralds. Aladdin then addressed his mother, "Madam, pray lose no time, before the Sultan and the Divan rise, I would have you return to the palace with this present as the dowry demanded for the princess, that he may judge by my diligence and exactness of the ardent and sincere desire I have to procure myself the honor of this alliance." As soon as this magnificent procession, with Aladdin's mother at its head, had begun to march from Aladdin's house, the whole city was filled with the crowds of people desirous to see so grand a sight. The graceful bearing, elegant form, and wonderful likeness of each slave, their grave walk at an equal distance from each other, the luster of their jeweled girdles, and the brilliancy of the aigrettes of precious stones in their turbans, excited the greatest admiration in the spectators. As they had to pass through several streets to the palace, the whole length of the way was lined with files of spectators. Nothing, indeed, was ever seen so beautiful and brilliant in the Sultan's palace, and the richest robes of the emirs of his court were not to be compared to the costly dresses of these slaves, whom they supposed to be kings. As the Sultan, who had been informed of their approach, had given orders for them to be admitted, they met with no obstacle, but went into the divan in regular order, one part turning to the right, and the other, to the left. After they were all entered, and had formed a semicircle before the Sultan's throne, the black slaves laid the golden trays on the carpet, prostrated themselves, touching the carpet with their foreheads, and at the same time the white slaves did the same. When they rose, the black slaves uncovered the trays, and then all stood with their arms crossed over their breasts. In the meantime, Aladdin's mother advanced to the foot of the throne, and having prostrated herself, said to the Sultan, "Sire, my son knows this present is much below the notice of Princess Buddir al-Buddoor, but hopes, nevertheless, that your majesty will accept of it, and make it agreeable to the princess, and with the greater confidence since he has endeavored to conform to the conditions you were pleased to impose." The Sultan, overpowered at the sight of such more than royal magnificence, replied without hesitation to the words of Aladdin's mother, "Go and tell your son that I wait with open arms to embrace him, and the more haste he makes to come and receive the princess my daughter from my hands, the greater pleasure he will do me." As soon as Aladdin's mother had retired, the Sultan put an end to the audience, and rising from his throne, ordered that the princess's attendants should come and carry the trays into their mistress's apartment, whither he went himself to examine them with her at his leisure. The 40 slaves were conducted into the palace, and the Sultan, telling the princess of their magnificent apparel, ordered them to be brought before her apartment, that she might see through the lattices he had not exaggerated in his account of them. In the meantime, Aladdin's mother reached home, and showed in her air and countenance the good news she brought her son. "My son," said she, "you may rejoice, you are arrived at the height of your desires. The Sultan has declared that you shall marry the Princess Buddir al-Buddoor. He waits for you with impatience." Aladdin, enraptured with this news, made his mother very little reply, but retired to his chamber. There he rubbed his lamp, and the obedient genie appeared. "Genie," said Aladdin, "convey me at once to a bath, and supply me with the richest and most magnificent robe ever worn by a monarch." No sooner were the words out of his mouth than the genie rendered him, as well as himself, invisible, and transported him into a hammam of the finest marble of all sorts of colors, where he was undressed, without seeing by whom, in a magnificent and spacious hall. He was then well rubbed and washed with various scented waters. After he had passed through several degrees of heat, he came out quite a different man from what he was before. His skin was clear as that of a child, his body lightsome and free, and when he returned into the hall, he found, instead of his own poor raiment, a robe the magnificence of which astonished him. The genie helped him to dress, and when he had done, transported him back to his own chamber, where he asked him if he had any other commands. Yes, answered Aladdin, bring me a charger that surpasses in beauty and goodness the best in the Sultan's stables, with a saddle, bridle, and other caparisons to correspond with his value. Furnish also 20 slaves, as richly clothed as those who carried the present to the Sultan, to walk by my side and follow me, and 20 more to go before me in two ranks. Besides these, bring my mother 6 women slaves to attend her, as richly dressed at least as any of the Princess Badr al-Budur's, each carrying a complete dress fit for any sultaness. I want also 10,000 pieces of gold in 10 purses, go, and make haste. As soon as Aladdin had given these orders, the genie disappeared, but presently returned with the horse, the 40 slaves, 10 of whom carried each a purse containing 10,000 pieces of gold, and 6 women slaves, each carrying on her head a different dress for Aladdin's mother, wrapped up in a piece of silver tissue, and presented them all to Aladdin. He presented the 6 women slaves to his mother, telling her they were her slaves, and that the dresses they had brought were for her use. Of the 10 purses, Aladdin took 4, which he gave to his mother, telling her those were to supply her with necessaries. The other 6 he left in the hands of the slaves who brought them, with an order to throw them by handfuls among the people as they went to the Sultan's palace. The 6 slaves who carried the purses he ordered likewise to march before him, 3 on the right hand and 3 on the left. When Aladdin had thus prepared himself for his first interview with the Sultan, he dismissed the genie, and immediately mounting his charger, began his march, and though he never was on horseback before, appeared with a grace the most experienced horseman might envy. The innumerable concourse of people through whom he passed made the air echo with their acclamations, especially every time the 6 slaves who carried the purses threw handfuls of gold among the populace.